Stan turned to page 876, probably one you know, in the key of B flat. 876.
Thank you.
You know this one the choir's going to sing. Sing along with us.
Got a text from Tammy Ross there earlier, and I know you talked to them, or to your son-in-law or your daughter or whatever, but it says they're going to be checking his labs in the morning, praying that the blood that they gave him today will help his pressure, that it don't drop. And when he gets put from the bed to the chair, that he'd be able to get to rehab here soon. So we certainly want to keep Jimmy Roberts, is who I'm talking about, I didn't say that, keep him in prayer. And still lifting up these others. Brian Hills in Caltway texted me earlier. He was in a car wreck and hit a couple telephone, I suppose, there in Grantline. But he's asking to keep him in prayer. He was all right, probably shook up, but I think he messed his car up. But keep him in prayer as well. So again, some of the things that we need to keep in prayer, and I'll just go ahead and start on prayer request right now. Chuck Creighton is back in the hospital for his back where he had surgery. Again, an excruciating pain. We've mentioned Jimmy Robert Stanley Hartman and Sherry Rings. They both need miracles. Their time here on earth is limited, which all of ours are, but again, they need a touch from the Master's hands. Bob Goforth for dialysis. I don't see Doug and Debbie here tonight, but I know Doug's asking for prayer for an aneurysm that he's going to have procedure done on. Still praying for Lloyd Bamford Jr. that's got some heart procedure coming up here in the near future. For Ernie Thompson with his knees, for David Wire and Mary Roberts, both with their eyes. And also for our grandfather, Bob Shepherd, for Karen Grayson, and for my wife with the other shot she's got to get here in April the 7th. And then for all the families, praying for Leon Minton, his granddaughter, and his friends. I know he's staying with a friend named George that, again, he had been in rehab with, and I think he's about to pass. And I think Leon, that's what he told me. Kind of that's why he hadn't been here at church. He's been trying to be there with his friends. So keep him in prayer. And then, again, for all those dealing with heart and other issues, still praying for Travis Barrett, for Judy Hall, for Melanie Wire with their hearts. Also, Dwayne Fleener with the heart as well. And again, for Shirley with her blood pressure as well. You still dealing with it, Shirley?
It's doing really good.
Oh, great. And then Bruce Cash, he'd been having trouble with his blood pressure as well. So, and still for Bonita Shaw, and there's an unspoken prayer request for some biopsy that somebody's waiting back for a good report. And of course, our country, and for that spirit of revival to stay in us and keep us going. Pray that that'll be real to each and every one of us. But going ahead and taking prayer requests tonight, starting up here, Dave.
Yes, for continued blessings on the ministry, wherever we go, whatever we do. We were with Elsie McCauley. He had heart surgery, and he had to go back in the hospital, and I didn't expect him to be there this morning. He was there, but he was weak. He was tired, but was recovering from that. Had the water on the heart thing, whatever all that is. And he's been kind of going through a tough time, so if we can remember him in prayer, really appreciate it. But wherever we get to go, and over there this morning, we had a great time with those folks, and we got another one coming up this week.
Yes.
So, yeah, that God would just move, that revival spirit would just go out everywhere.
Absolutely.
And overwhelm, please.
Absolutely. Amen. Wife?
Myself, family, friends, and God is great. God is good.
He is.
His mercy and grace is bigger than all of our sins.
Oh, no problems.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's God.
One unspoken.
Absolutely. Others? Prayer request out here, anybody? Lisa?
Yeah, for Serena and Todd on the way home from Kentucky.
Just they were at Campbellsville, Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Other prayer request status?
Yes, for my family, especially for my daughter, Evelyn.
Okay. Dolores?
That God's will happen for Brandon.
Okay. Michelle?
All my family.
Absolutely. Remember my stepmother, too. We got to take her Friday. She's going to be having some places in her, I guess, veins in her legs unstopped or unclogged. So pray that that all work out for her, because I know she's had some falls because of that. But anyway, Maxine McClellan, remember her for prayer this, again, Friday's when they'll be doing that. Other prayer requests, Mary?
Still for Addie, she's
popping
on, not feeling good still, and then
unspoken please. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Well, how many have uplifted hands for yourself or someone else? As we stand tonight, if any of you'd like to be anointed for yourself or someone else, you're more than welcome to come down and be anointed. If not, you're welcome to stay where you're at. If you'd like to take hands or however you'd like to do that tonight. Anybody? Okay. Well, let's agree in prayer here this evening.
I'm having trouble connecting to the internet. Check your Wi-Fi network connection by going to settings.
It's my Kindle. For some reason, it's
this in is the day. This.
Yeah, I'm having the same problems.
I want to make sure I was connected before we're...
Yeah, let's get connected.
Okay. I haven't touched it since I walked in the building. I don't know what's
on the main line.
Absolutely. Praise God. Father God, we just thank you tonight, Lord, that your love and your mercy is here for us. We thank you, God, that again, you don't leave us nor forsake us. And we just ask you tonight, Lord, as we've got, again, petition after petition and prayers, that God, we can bring them to you in faith believing, Lord. We know that there's nothing impossible with God. We know that there's some things and trials in people's lives that God, they don't know how to overcome. None of us do many times. But God, we know the God that cares, Lord. And we do lift up needs tonight, Lord. We do pray for those in the hospital right now, for Chuck Cranin. We do pray for that pain that he's got in his back after surgery. Lord, it just seems unbearable to him, and we just pray, God, that you're going to make a way, help him through that. For Jimmy Roberts, we pray that the blood is not going to continue to leak, and God, he's going to be able to get that blood pressure back up and to be able to get transferred to rehab here in the near future. Still, for Stanley Hartman and Sherry Raines, need miracles in their lives. For Bob Goforth with dialysis. For Doug Cave, we pray for that aneurysm to be taken care of. For the ones such as Ernie with his knees, and also these ones with their eyes, for David Wire, Mary Roberts to get her other eye, and both of his, for David. Still praying for our grandfather, Bob. For Karen Grayson, still from a wife, was another shot she's got to be getting. For all the families, we pray for Brian Hills, who was involved in a car wreck, that God, you'll be with him and help him to get his needs taken care of. And again, if there's shook-upness in him, I pray that you'll help him. And again, we do pray for the family of Bert Jackson that passed away the other day. Pray that you'll comfort hearts and lives, especially for the wife and for the children. Be with them. And again, for our stepmother, Maxine, is having a procedure coming up this Friday. Also for LC, the pastor, we pray, God, your touch upon him.
Yes.
And again, for all those with heart and back and blood pressures and all the different issues, we just lift each and every one of them up to you. We pray for our nation. We pray for revival to break out and to stay breaking out, Lord. We pray that it'll not just stop at Asbury College or one of the other places, but it'll just erupt in every one of our hearts. Help us to look for that each and every day of our life.
Right.
God, may that revival begin in all of us, Lord. What they had back in the 50s and the 60s, we can have greater today, because greater is he that's in us.
Hallelujah.
And Lord, the closer we get, the nearer we are. And I pray that up over each and every one of us, and may we receive from you as we give our hearts and life totally over to you. And again, cleanse us from any unrighteousness. May we all have clean hands and a pure heart.
Hallelujah.
Search us, and if there's anything that would offend, we ask God for purifying, even in our everyday life, for all
thank
of us.
You, Lord.
And we ask all these things in the precious name
thank
of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
And all God's children said,
Amen.
And amen. Praise God. He wants to do the offering. Lord, help him. And also, next Sunday night, T.C. Baker will be here with us. Hopefully now that our nights and days are getting a little bit longer, maybe we'll have a bigger crowd for that. But pass the word along that he'll be with us next Sunday night. And his wife will be opening him up in song for that evening. And look forward to that. I think most of us like, again, the way he ministers. And still praying for the revival service. We want it to be in every service, but also with Kelly James Goddell, that'll be with us the 18th or the 16th to the 19th. And again, that'll be our anniversary date for the church also, that first night or the first morning of that. That'll be a pitch-in dinner. And you that come at night, if you want to come after your church service, you're welcome to do so. But anyway, let's pray over the offer. Father God, we just thank you tonight, Lord, also once again for the opportunity to give to the work of the Lord. We pray your blessings upon the offering tonight for those that have to give as well as those that have not. And we ask God that, again, whatever we do, any of us, Lord, that we do it all to your glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
John 14:27. He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. We were talking about this morning, don't be worried for tomorrow. We need to have hope in Jesus for every day. Again, we're talking about God's eternal peace. We're talking about even His inward peace that we need in every one of our lives. That though the world throws everything it can at you, Satan throws everything it can at you, your loved ones throw many times everything it can at you. People that you think are best friends, and they throw some of the worst things at you sometimes. But no matter what comes your way, you can still have that peace that passes all understanding. Again, I like to get close to water. I'm not talking about jumping in, drowning, or jumping in, swimming. I'm talking about, I just like to be by the water brook, something I see water moving or something. I used to go out there by the river there in Jeffersonville where Duffy's Landing is and just go out there. And actually, I even had Darryl Meyer when he was still alive. He'd go with me. We'd go down there and pray before we come to choir practice a lot of times on Sunday and different times. And we'd just sit out there and watch the water and just pray. And just sense the presence of God. Not because of something special about the water, but there's something special about where there's a peaceful serenity. You ones that hunt and fish and things like that, and I know it's guy stuff, but I know gals do it sometimes too, but there's something about that time, that majesticness of God, not just in our clouds, but in creation itself. And just being near what God has created us. You know, we talked about the birds of the air. You know, they don't reap or sow, yet your Heavenly Father takes care of them. And how much more does He take care of us?
Amen.
That are created in His image and His likeness? Turn over to Romans 4:17 tonight. I know we've been here before, but again, it says, as it is written, I have made thee, talking about Abraham, a father of many nations. Before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth, that word quickeneth again means made alive the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were. And I've heard people say, you know, we can do that. We can call things that be not as though they were. And that's fine. I guess that's faith. But it says God is the one that calleth those things that be not as though they were. I know faith has to do with that also. But at the same time, it says, He makes it, again, quickeneth or makes alive the dead, and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope. And that scripture always gets a hold of me because a lot of people in this world don't have hope in their life at all. I mean, and I don't want to say they're hopeless, but their lives in their own hearts are hopeless to them because it says, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. We talked about that a little bit this morning, not out of Romans, but another scripture, and talked about how God told him that he would have seed as the sands of the sea and as the stars of the sky. Again, he was talking about, again, the descendants that would come from Isaac. We even talked about there in Hebrews where he accounted God able to raise him from the dead if he was to have took his life there when he was tested up there on Mount Moriah, however you pronounce that. And again, when he was about to take his own son's life, and we even mentioned Brother Dave, how he recalled that God supplied the lamb instead of a ram that he gave that day, and the lamb would be the Son of the living God. Amen. But again, as we looked at this, we're looking at Abraham, and again, he's hope against hope. And again, how many of us have had things where it seemed hopeless in our lives? And maybe, you know, you didn't lose your hope in Christ for salvation or your hope in eternal, but you had hope in about getting something straightened out, and it's like, I don't know how this is ever going to get fixed. I don't know how this is ever going to get realigned or anything else, but God. And I said, but God, He can intervene, can He? When it's, you know, we were talking about this morning, you know, God will take care of your food, your clothing, whatever, you know. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and the things you have need of, God will give it to you.
He will.
I'm not talking about giving you necessarily a big mansion or, well, I guess we get one of them too, don't we?
We do.
My goodness, I forgot about that. We are getting a mansion our way. But I'm talking about a physical mansion here. And again, if you've got food and clothing and a roof over your head, what's wrong with that anyway? God takes care of us, don't it? But again, there's times people feel like there is no hope. Even in Christians' lives, we get some hopeless times, and we need to realize that we can be like Abraham and hope against hope and believe that God has promised that he'll never leave nor forsake us. And if I remember right, he said he'll supply our every need according to his riches and glory, didn't he? But it says,
amen.
Verse 19, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, which is about 90. He staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief. And again, unbelief's a rough thing. We've talked about the man that had the son that kept falling into water and fire and was asking for the disciples to pray that demonic spirit out of his son. And again, you know the story. And I'm not trying to break the record on it. I'm just trying to say we got to sometimes be like that guy. Lord God, I believe, but help my unbelief. And he's not saying strengthen my unbelief. He's saying help me to get through it.
Get where I need to be.
Because there's some unbelief sometimes. When I'm going through a tragedy or a heartbreak or something, I don't know how in the world I'm going to make it. And I can still believe in Christ and in eternity, but I need to get through this very moment. I'm looking for eternity in heaven, but I'm going through some junk right here on earth right now. And I know everybody's had some times like that. And it says, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead. And again, they're talking about having children at this age. But again, regardless of your age, it says, considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief, but was strong, not in his physical well-being, but in faith. And what does it say? Giving glory to God. Lord, I don't know how you're going to bring me through the storm, but I'm going to praise you anyway.
Amen.
I don't know how you're going to get me through the financial need I have, but I'm going to praise you, Lord. I don't know how I'm going to get through these wayward children or living like the devil, but I'm going to praise you, Lord. I don't know how I'm going to get through this hurt in my body, but I'm going to praise you, Lord.
Amen.
Doesn't the Bible say, let everything that has breath praise the Lord? And again, I say unto you, praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Over Psalms 150. But it says, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform.
Amen.
And again, you know, the older you get, as I mentioned this morning, the closer you get to thinking about eternity, you realize that one of these days that light switch is going to flick. And you know what I'm talking about. I don't know what it's going to be like at that very moment. None of you do. None of us do. People that have crossed over, they do. But there's some scary times in that. I'm not talking about being scared about going to heaven, but I'm talking about what's going to happen when that time comes. What's going to take place. Like I said, I'd like to just close my eyes and wake up in heaven. How about you? That would be wonderful.
Yeah.
Or for that, you know, a rushing mighty wind to come through and take you up like a whirlwind, like Elijah or some of the others, be translated like Enoch. That would be wonderful, but at the same time, I don't know the day or the hour no more than you do. But it says, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. And therefore it was imputed or accounted to him for righteousness. Why? Because he was fully persuaded that God was able to do what he said. Are you fully persuaded that God's able to do what you need in your life?
He is able.
Again, I'm not talking about foolish things. You know, the Bible tells us over James, you know, there's things that we ask and don't receive because we ask amiss or we ask wrongfully. I'm not talking about those things, but I'm talking about when we're asking for things. How many of you are praying for family members to be saved, praying for loved ones to get right with God, praying for revival? And again, don't let that be a broken record in your mind. Let it be something you desire. Don't quit desiring. Be fully persuaded that God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Again, as we've said, there's nothing impossible with God. Everything things impossible with us in our own strength, but there's nothing impossible.
That's right.
You know, there's a place in Scripture that says, I can't do anything. I can do nothing, I should say, without Him.
That's right.
I need Him every way. But it says, and therefore it was imputed to Him for righteousness. Now it was written for His Now, I'm sorry, that was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if, that's their conjunction, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus, our Lord, from the dead. I dare say everybody in this building here tonight believes that.
Yes, sir.
Even the ones in the nursery, they've heard it through their, you know, back there in the nursery and everything else. I know we don't have a lot of numbers, but same time, I believe all of us would surely, hopefully, believe that coming to church on a Sunday night at least. But at the same time, believe on him that raised up Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses. That's why he was given into the hands of those Roman soldiers.
That's right.
Remember Peter chopped a man's ear off?
He did.
Marcius, I think, was the guy's name, and Jesus had to go, he didn't sew it on, he just prayed it right back on, or spoke it right back onto his head, praise God, and told Peter he didn't know what kind of deal he was, and told him to put the sword up. But again, nobody took Jesus' life anyway, did they?
No, he laid it down.
He laid it down for each and every one of us, praise
That's right.
God. And again, as the old song says, when he was on the cross, we were on his mind. He never stopped thinking about us. You know, that's a wonderful song to think about sometimes. All the songs with a good meaning are. But that one especially, because again, when he was up there and, you know, he was crying out to the Lord, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do. He was talking about everybody, not just Roman soldiers, not just those Jewish hypocrites. He was talking about all of us. Because none of us know what we're doing without Christ, do we? None of us know what we're doing without salvation in our life. It says, that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification.
Yes, he was.
Going into the fifth chapter there. Therefore, being justified by faith, that verse that we just read, who was raised again for our justification. Have you all did everything perfect this week? Have you ever got everything ever right in your life?
No.
We try, we strive, we do our best, but we have trials and tribulations. We have temptations. We have weaknesses. We have things that beat the daylights out of us. But we're not justified because of our good works, are we? We're justified being justified by faith. That faith needs to be in Jesus Christ, doesn't it? We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Wouldn't it be terrible if every time you failed the Lord, you thought, I've lost?
Oh my gosh.
I'm gone. I can't make it now. I've messed up. Hebrews 6, it talks about, you know, I could never be right. Hebrews 10, it talks about, and there's some scriptures that if you don't understand them, they sound like if you backslide, you're just doomed for hell. There's no way, and it's actually talking about if you quit depending on Jesus Christ for your salvation. But that's where it all comes to, is trusting in Jesus, believing that Christ is going to carry me through. I'm justified by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that He's going to save my soul. He's already saved me. How about you tonight?
Yes.
I don't have to worry, as we said this morning, I don't have to worry about tomorrow, because I don't know what the world holds about tomorrow or what anything else, but I know that God holds it all, don't you? I know the song says He holds my hand. He's going to carry me through every storm,
Amen.
Every trial, every tribulation. And again, when I'm weak, He's strong. When I fall down, He lifts me up. When I give up, He keeps pressing on. When I, you know, whatever you're going through, distress, perplexion, anything, God's still going to carry us, isn't He?
Amen.
I mean, when I trust in Him, I mean trusting Him more than you trust yourself. We're not trustworthy usually, are we? We fail ourselves, don't we?
Amen.
And we need somebody that we can look up to.
Yes.
And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. It says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace. Remember Jesus said, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. But He gives us that peace that passes on our side. We don't have to let our heart be troubled. We don't have to let the cares of this world destroy us. That doesn't mean they're not going to keep coming at you. Just because the preacher preached about it on Sunday night or Sunday morning, that ain't going to change it. It's still going to have storms in this life. You're still going to have problems. But again, we got to remember those things. That's why every one of us need to study to show ourselves approved. That's why every one of us need to keep our nose to the grinds with God. Yeah, we need to read and study our Bible, but also we need to pray and believe that God's going to take us through everything we go through. And He's the one that's going to bring revival. He's the one that's going to bring a move of the Holy Spirit. He's the one that's going to stir our hearts and lives up. I know there's some cost in our lives. I know that we've got to be willing to lay down our lives. You know, the Bible says, He that cometh to me must believe that I am. Talking about Jesus, and I am a rewarder of them who diligently seek Him. But He also says that we must take up our cross daily.
That's right.
And follow Him.
Follow Him.
Taking up your cross means I've died to this old flesh. I'm not wanting to live according to my plans and my purposes. Yeah, I'm going to live a normal. You know, you're going to go through your daily routine, whatever you do. I'm not telling you that you got to be abnormal as far as human beings. You got things you got to do. You got jobs. You got things you got to take care of at your home. But at the same time, you're allowing God to be there with you. Colossians said, whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord wholeheartedly, right. Praise God. And we'll keep our mind on Him. And again it says, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access.
We do.
You know, we've got cars that we've got locks on. We've got houses that we've got door locks. We've got locks to our buildings, even our church buildings. We've got places, you know. And to be able to get access, you've got to have the way or the means to get in. Normally that's a key. And what is our key? John 3:16.
Yes.
What is our key? That God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Again, that's our access. Again, if we shall confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. But it says also we have access by faith into this grace. We're saved by grace through faith, not of works. This any man should boast, Ephesians talks about. Wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Again, there's that hope word again, isn't it? Who against hope, hoped.
Yes, hope.
But anyway, we need that in our life. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations. Also knowing that tribulation worketh patience. When you're going through tough times, realize that you're going through them with God.
Yes.
Realize that there's a reason. Again, all things work together to good for them that love the Lord and are called according to His purposes. Right, Tom? Over in Romans 8:32, I believe it is. But at the same, or 8:28, but at the same time, we realize that, again, I don't like the problems. I don't like the situation. I just wouldn't. Everything was clouded down all the time. How about you? But I know better, don't you? I know that somebody's going to upset me. I know somebody's going to cut me off in traffic. I know somebody's probably going to give me a number one sign sometime. I know that people are going to talk behind your back. I know, you know, everybody knows. You're going to have trouble with your children, your spouses, your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones. You love them, but you still have trials and tribulations. You're going to have troubles in this life. And again, please don't say all those things. I want to think that I never have any problems or anything else. But again, just being honest with us to know that, again, we can trust in God. Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. Again, we were talking about Hebrews 11 this morning. We read through the first 19 verses, and we would have read on into the 12th chapter. We talk about those elders that obtained a good report. Many of them died for their faith. Many of them obtained a better resurrection because they were martyrs for the kingdom of God. They were willing to have greater love than this, to lay down their life for not only themselves, but for the Lord Jesus Christ. And patience, experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God, and we all need that, is shed abroad in our hearts. By what?
The Holy Ghost.
By the Holy Ghost. And we need that, don't we? We need to trust in Him,
yeah,
which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died
for the ungodly.
For the ungodly. Well, that's a pretty good Joe. I don't know if he... We've all been ungodly, you know it. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. I'm not giving us a license to sin. I'm just saying we've all messed up. We've all come short of that. But it says, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us. That means he made it available. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Again, that goes back to, I'm going to wait until I get everything perfect and then Christ will accept me. God knew that I'd never get perfect.
Yeah, that doesn't work.
Because there's no way that I can ever get everything perfectly lined up in my life. I mean, even in my Christian faith, I still have failures. Even in your Christian faith, you're going to have failures. I'm not talking about committing vile sin purposely. I'm just talking about every day. If you're not omission, you're commission. There's some things that we should do that we don't do at the same time also. I know there's a lot of things that we shouldn't do, we do anyway, but I'm talking about there's some things that we should do sometimes that God's calling us to, and he's still working on us, and he's still patient with us, as we need to be patient also. But it says, he commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies... You mean we've been enemies to God? The Bible tells us over in 1 John, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and all well, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, they're not of the Father, but of this world. That's an enmity with God. But again, even with that, doesn't the Bible tell us to love our enemies?
Yes.
Even the people that's done us wrong, those that are persecuted, those that slandered us and said bad things about us, that's not always easy, I know. But at the same time, you still got to love those people that come against you. And again, love don't mean you necessarily have to like them, but you got to treat them right regardless. But it says, for if when we were enemies we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement, the reconciliation. It brought us back to the right relationship with God. You couldn't give the blood of goats and bulls and turtle doves and all the sacrifices and offerings and do all the holy day things and rituals. It had to be the perfect atonement, that lamb that we were talking about earlier, that lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world that we could be saved. Anyway, I'm going to stop there, and I want you to turn over to Ephesians with me also tonight. Ephesians chapter 2 for a moment, and I've got one other place after that. But Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. When you get there, say amen.
Amen.
Ephesians 2, 4 says, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us. Do you get the ideal of God loving you tonight? Do you get the ideal that God cares about you? Do you get the ideal that he didn't just make us so he could send us to hell? You know, I think some people's got that ideal that God just created man so he could send them to hell. You know, hell wasn't created for man, was it? It said it was created for the fallen angels, but because of the fall. It says hell has enlarged its mouth, I think, over in the book of Psalms it talks about that. But anyway, it says, but God, who is rich in his mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when, past tense, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened, there's that word quickened, made alive again, quickened us together with Christ. And again, there's the famous verse, by grace ye are saved. God's unmerited favor, you didn't discern it. You didn't deserve it, you didn't earn it, you didn't do anything to get it. It was God's gift to you. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Has he showed you kindness lately? For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship. We are created for good works, by the way. But we don't give good works to get saved. We give good works because we are saved. Praise God. I hope I've said that enough times. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I want you to turn one more place with me to Luke 6:31 tonight, and we'll close after that. Luke 6:31. And this will be the last place. And as you would that man should do to you, do you also to them likewise. Seems like we've read that before in other places in Beatitudes too, isn't it? For if you love them which love you, what thank have you? For sinners also love those that love them. I thought we was only supposed to love the people at North Charlestown Church of God.
Right.
You mean we got to love people other places? And not just in other churches. But you got to love that drunk down the street, don't you?
Yes.
You got to love that drug addict down the road. I don't like what they're doing no more than you do. The pimp, the prostitute, you got to love them too. All the people that are, you know, and again, love has to do with the way you treat, not necessarily feel about people. But at the same time, God didn't say he just loved the perfect, because that would leave all of us out. It doesn't say he just loved the saved, because that would be worthless. We might as well die and go to heaven when we get saved, hadn't we? I used to think about that. It's like, you know, if that was all that we were good for, when we come to the altar and get saved, you ought to just kill us and take us to heaven and be done with it. It's like, that don't make sense. We're here for a reason, aren't we? Mm-hmm. He said, the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. Pray that he'll send laborers in the harvest. Who are those laborers? All of us. Steve was talking about there earlier, you know, that our works will follow us. You know, he's talking about judgment. I think, David Jeremiah he was talking about listening to, but talking about, you know, why don't God just go ahead and judge us right now, or go ahead and get it over with? And it's like, there's going to be things happen even after we die. I kind of like that, because there is, you know, your life is going to affect your children and even their children, and whatever comes past that. The people that you've worked with, the people that you've been around, it's going to affect their lives. You was talking about your dad had somebody come when he was about to pass away and said, I'm so glad that you led my dad to the Lord, because that's what got me to the Lord. How many of you have had people in your life that are no longer with us, but they affected your life today? Do you know that your rewards are their rewards? Doesn't the Bible tell us that whatever we do, you know, it talks about even preachers, when you give to the work of the Lord, if a preacher wins somebody to the Lord, guess what? That's not just a reward for the preacher, but that's a reward for everybody that's a part of that. And I'm not just talking about money, but that could be a part of it. Whatever you're doing, bringing somebody to church, bringing somebody to hear somebody sing, bringing some, whatever. All of us get rewarded, you know. And again, I'm not talking about doing things just to get rewards. I don't think anybody's just looking for that. But there's nothing wrong with it either, is there? Nothing wrong with God blessing you. But it says, for if you love them which love you, what thank have you? For sinners also love those that love them. And if you do good to them which do you good, what thank have you? For sinners also do the same. And if you lend to them of whom you hope to receive, what thank have you? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much as again. But love ye, here we go, but love ye your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and ye shall be what?
The children
of the highest. Again, remember Matthew 25. I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was naked, you clothed me. I was in prison, you visited me. I was sick and you came to me. All the things. When did we do that? As much as you did it unto the least of these, my brethren, you did it unto me. But it says, you shall be the children of the highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful, and to the evil. That person that don't thank you when you do good to them, you just want to knock them upside the head sometimes, right? But that's not what we do, is it? We've got to love them anyway, don't we? Mm-hmm. I'm talking about our flesh. We all have a wrestle with the flesh, don't we? Mm-hmm. But at the same time, again, be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. And that's always another one that you got to keep practice up on, forgiving. Like I said, we read about the man in the Bible that, again, was forgiven of a great amount, and then he went out and got a guy by the neck and wouldn't forgive him of just a little bit of nothing. And it says afterwards he lost all his forgiveness. And I know people say, once you're forgiven, you can never lose that. Well, folks, I've got a few things in the scripture I think I'd beg to differ with that. But again, we can't ask God for forgiveness and not forgive other people. But it says, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure.
Pressed down.
Pressed down and shaken together and running over shall man give unto your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. And he spake a parable unto them, can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall into the ditch? The disciple is not above his master, but everyone that is perfect, that word perfect, don't get sinless perfect mixed up there. It's talking about mature. But anyway, everyone that is perfect shall be as his master. And why beholdest that mote that's in thy brother's eye, but perceiveth not the beam that is in thy own eye? Nothing wrong with helping your brother get the speck out, but make sure you don't got the beam. It says, either how canst thou say to thy brother, brother, let me pull out the mote that is in thy eye, when thou thyself beholdest not the beam that is in thy own eye? Thou hypocrite, cast out first the beam out of thy own eye, and then shall thou see clearly to pull out the mote that is in thy brother's eye. For a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bringeth forth good fruit. For every tree is known by its own fruit. For of thorns man do not gather figs, nor a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man, don't the Bible say that you'll know a man by his works or by his fruits? But anyway, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasures of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. Sometimes you got to know who to hang out with and who not to hang out with.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that you can't go out and try to win sinners to Christ, but that means you can't go out there and participate in the same things they're doing and call yourself righteous in the sight of God. Because I'm not dependent on God no more. I'm dependent on my own deals. And Dave used to talk about going out with some friends that you cared about, and for one reason and one reason only. And you say, well, I thought that's contrary. Well, didn't Jesus get accused of going out?
He did.
Eating and drinking. He was called a glutton and a wine bibber at one time because he hung around those people. He didn't go out there to get all soused up and, nope, you know, get all goofed up. He went out there to share his light, didn't he, to let the love of Jesus show through. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and dig deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose, it said, the stream beat vehemently, strongly upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. Are you not founded upon the rock of Jesus Christ tonight? Amen. But he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth against, notice the earth, against which the streams did beat, well, I'll go back to that, foundation built a house upon the earth against which the stream did beat vehemently or strongly, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. Why? Because it wasn't built upon the rock. We are built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ tonight, aren't we? We're built upon the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we believe that because He died and rose again, we're going to rise again one of these days too. And we believe that because He lives in us. Let's stand tonight. We're going to have prayer and close out here tonight. If you have a need, you're always welcome to this altar. If you have a need to talk with me afterwards you want to pray about, we can do that also. If not, we're going to go ahead and pray and dismiss. And thank God that we still got some sunlight. I know some of you all have trouble with that. So again, but Father God, we just thank you tonight, Lord, for being a blessing in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to have your good fruits within us, not our own. And we just ask you, Lord, that we be encouraged today, that we would encourage others to do the same, to know that we know that we know that everything's well between us. Bring us back safely when the opportunity comes and help us to always be in your will and in your purposes as we go out into whatever places we go at throughout tonight, tomorrow, and whatever times of our life. And again, let your peace that passes all understanding be upon us all. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And all God's children said,
amen. Amen.
God bless you. Come back and be with us Wednesday night. And again, remember next Sunday morning service, and also next Sunday night, T.C. Baker and Sherita will be with us. God bless you.